it's real!
Thanks for coming. Hey, we got a full house. That's nice. This is technically my clinic, but in reality, it's your clinic. So without further ado, I'm going to turn the ball over to you guys.
Tanner Crank was wondering, why did you want to start playing bass?
I did not want to start playing bass. Bass chose me. I joined the band as a guitar player and could not play guitar very well. And we had a gentleman by the name of Terry Saunders who used to come in and teach the band all the latest stuff. At that time, we were playing stuff by the Animals and by Paul. Paul Revere and the Raiders and the Stones and stuff like that. So anyway, he came in, he assessed the band, and in his assessment, he looked at me and said, you play bass. And we looked around and said, what's the bass? And, you know, and they went down and picked up one at the local music store, and that's kind of how it all started. So I play off of these two fingers, this one and this one. And I play by position, so I'm moving up and down the neck quite a bit. But these two fingers are always on the strings, and this is, you know, I control how much I want it to be muted or not. And so that's how I do it. I couldn't tell you honestly how to do it that way because I've never done it that way. Musically though, we never really had a lot of problems with that. You know, everybody's got pretty good ears. You know, as far as me and Dave, there's not really an issue there. You know, except, you know, obviously staying out of each other's way. And it's just a matter of listening. With Chester, it's a little different because, you know, he's a natural, he plays bass naturally while he's comping himself. He comped himself. I mean, he's a jazz cat, so. And so he doubles, he would double a lot of stuff or play kind of in and out of a lot of stuff that I was doing. So very seldom would he get in the way. Sometimes a keyboard, because the tonality of it is so overbearing that I would have to say, you know what, during that part right there or something like that, you know, maybe go to a different octave or, you know, delay out there, let me have that. Or if you really want it that bad, I'll lay out, you know, it's, you know, makes it easy. So that's, you know, real simple, straight ahead. It's so easy to overthink. It's, you know, I try to stay out of my own way as much as possible. You know, and just, you know, I know what the part is. It's just a matter of executing it correctly and, you know, making sure I fall where I'm supposed to when the change comes, you know. And that's really it. Just trying to make sure I get it right. It's our player, yes. Personally, I think Jeff and Willie probably fit the band the best. You know, they knew a lot about the concept of space, less is more. My biggest complaint with guitar players is overplaying and too loud. And that seems to be an ongoing struggle. The way I learned was from this gentleman that used to come in and teach us all the time. And then it kind of just went from there. Emilio, or Mimi, the leader of the band, he kind of took that over that role as time went on. He had the ears for it. He could hear parts and separate. And it's his band. And so he knew what he was, you know, wanted to hear. So he would kind of guide everybody in that direction. And now everything else is just... That's why I play like I do, because I never did take a lesson. Very unique, yeah.
On a song like What Is Hip, you got so many different instruments going all the time.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't there like an urge, like, you know what, we should put more guitar in this, or maybe we, you know, because it starts out, you got guitars, and you got horns, and you got Lenny Williams. I mean, doesn't that make it kind of difficult to put a song like that together?
It's not just that song. I mean, every song that we do has horn parts. You got vocals, you got backgrounds, every song. You know, and it's a 10-piece band. So there's always something going on. yeah, no, the biggest thing is playing your part, you know. Play your part, do your job, you know. And, you know, you're going to work that out while you're learning the tune, you know. So you're going to know if you play such and such here, you know, you're stepping on somebody or you're not letting them breathe enough, you know, for another part to be heard, you know, and that's really important, you know, as, and you just have to be conscious of that all the time. As a bass player, my job is a certain function, and it's not to be out there whacking away and, you know, making a bunch of noise. It's to play bass, you know what I mean, and make that part be the foundation, part of the foundation. And everything else layers on top of that. I mean, you pick your spots, you know, you try to get away whenever you can. But you do, but you know, and that's what you should do, you know, but do it in a tasteful manner and make sure you don't step on nobody, that's all. It comes from definitely a feel thing, you know. I mean, if you have to think about it, you know, that you're just gonna drive yourself nuts. You know, there's, you know, you go from a change here to there, and you know, you don't necessarily need all that tonality, but you want that percussive and that drive, like you said. And it's definitely a feel thing, you know. Yeah. I'll show you a good phrase. You can avoid carpal tunnel or anything like that. I don't know if that's something you can actually avoid.
Do you have a lot of warm-up exercise?
No. I mean, I do. And I'll do that up to the 12th fret, and then I'll do... I'll do that all the way up. But that's pretty much the extent of my exercise.
You know, stretches or something weird like that?
Yeah, sometimes, you know, I'll stretch out if I'm having problems with cramps, which now that I'm a little bit older, I have a tendency to go through times when, you know, I do get cramps, and not necessarily because of playing, but I think because the lack of, you know, some sort of medication, you know, but yeah, I'll stretch every now and then. If I feel like it's necessary. I mean, I gotta feel like it's, you know, I'm having a problem of some kind to, you know, I'll just do it.
Ed Fonseca is asking, how often do you change strings?
I change them more often than I ever have, but usually when they start to be dead, you know. I mean, in the old days, I played them forever, until they broke, you know. But no, more often than I ever have.
When did you realize you wanted to play music for the rest of your life?
I don't know. I mean, I think you go through crossroads in your life, I think, you know. And for me, they happen fairly young. You know, we auditioned at the Fillmore. Oh, God, I think it was late 69. So I joined the band in 65. I was 14. So at that time, it looked like it was, you know, something actually might happen. So that was a pretty serious crossroads at that time. So, but Yeah. Again, I think music chooses you, too. I mean, I'm a firm believer in that, you know. It's like, just go with the flow.
So what was the scene like in the East Bay in San Francisco back in the late 60s and the early 70s with players like Larry Graham and yourself and Sly Stone in the mix? There was a lot of magic coming at CCR, Credence.
It was a real
great time, huh?
Real special time in music history, and we were right in the center of it.
That's right.
You know,
good parties too, huh?
we associated ourselves with the East Bay because it was a different sound than what was coming out of San Francisco. You know, there was a very, you know, you had Santana, and you had, you can go on, but, you know, and Bill Graham and the Fillmore, you know, which was, I mean, if you were playing the Fillmore, you were doing it, you know. But it was a real special time, and there's no question about it. We usually, whoever writes the tune has a general idea what direction they want it to go, and they tell the rest of the band. You know, they either want it to, you know, be like a Memphis thing or a Philly thing or a James Brown thing or something, you know, and they have a tempo in mind, and then they kind of turn it over to us unless they have a real specific beat in mind, you know, then they'll say what that is. But in general, we're pretty much left to, okay, go for it, and, you know, just play around with it until we find something comfortable. And then we go from there. I mean, it's not just me that needs to be comfortable. It's, you know, I might have this, you know, in my head, it's a killer part, but it doesn't go with the tune, so, you know.
Can you show us how to play the Oakland Stroke?
Oh, God.
I suffer when I was playing for your seat with that song, because it only happens on the Tower Show, it only happens for like bars.
I know.
And I'm like, what the hell is it doing?
Yeah, you know? Well, that's a good question. Yeah, more water.
The bass comes in a weird beat on the song, right?
Like, yeah.
And then he goes from there. And
how about that? I couldn't tell you how it's put together as far as time. I don't know. For some reason, I always followed Dave whenever he did the two cymbal swishes. And that's when I came in. So, and that's what I would do.
Did he ever mess with you and not play the switches?
Oh, hell no.
But that's not the tempos you guys are playing that stuff. You guys are flying through that.
Yeah, it was, you know, it's funny because, you know, I listen to a lot of that stuff, and it's like, wow, we played it that fast. And it's like, you know, you can't just hit that cold, you know?
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Pancho Tomaselli.
Hello.
He's the bass player with War, and he's the reason I am with ESP now, and I'm going to let him tell you a little about his story.
Hello, guys. Bass royalty here, so bow. Well, I had the chance to sit in while Rocco stepped off the tower throne and sat in sub for Rocco for like some like 17 shows in November with Tower. And it was just an incredible experience to, in a couple of days, I'm playing Lowrider, and then 3 days later, I'm playing What Is Hip with Tower of Power. from like the most drugged out funk music to the most methodical, you know, like crazy, you know. And I asked Dave the same thing, is there charts? And it was like silence. It was, nope, we'll send you a two files of this 2 1.5 hour sets that you need to learn. It was Tuesday and the gig was Friday, right? And something I don't like to do covers unless I'm getting paid, because I think when you do a lot of other people's music, then you take away your own sound. So like, it was kind of incredible that the first time that we got to play What Is Hip was with the entire Tower of Power right there, and Rocco was in the audience. After the show, he told me, I like those new bass lines they're putting in my music. I'm like, all right, thank you, right? But it was a very humbling experience to like not only sit on that throne, you know, from like peasant to royalty in like 2 seconds, and have him there, you know, coaching me through it, and I don't know, it's just like it was a way to. It was very, very cool, very, very cool experience, you know, from punk to funk, I call it. Just happened.
he has a band called, his own band called
Film, yeah. It's drummer Dave Lombardo from Slayer, and also crazy other guitar player. It's like a Weather Report meets Black Flag, kind of, you know, it's like really, really weird. And
tell them about the story of you and Jeff bringing me
in. Well, I got my own line of basses. I'm a signature artist for ESP, thanks to Jeff and all the cats over there. And we've been doing a lot of shows together with War and Tower of Power. And I went up to Uncle Rocco and I said, listen, look, I just signed a deal with ESP and they're really treating me nice. They're really, really great with their artists, you know. They pay me to say that. And So I went up to Rocco and I said, you know, why don't we go in? You know, I'm sure like if we walked you in, you know, they'll give whatever. And it happened. I went to Jeff and I go, hey, do you want me to bring Rocco Prestia into ESP? And he's like, is the Pope Catholic? You know, it's like, well, so it happened.
Well, he kept telling me, he said, man, ESP, man, these guys are great, blah, 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 blah. And at the time, I was working on a deal with a German company. And I said, yeah, you know. I mean, I never heard of ESP, so I didn't know what. So anyway, my German deal fell apart, and I said, Pancho, that thing still happening, man?
I would do that ESP company. I said, well, they're there, and like I said, you know, it took Jeff, flew Rocco into LA, we met, and then the rest is history, you know. They came up with a beautiful bass guitar, you know, super light and super punchy and powerful, you know, and I'm just happy, you know, that it happened, you know.
Marshall Tomaselli.
Thank you, guys. Thank you. I'm not done with the questions, though.
I saw this. It was, when they finally gave the go-ahead that we were going to actually do something and put something together, you know, they said, well, maybe look through everything that we got, and if you see a body style that you like, and I saw this body style. It was a little bit different than this one is. A little bit more more cut like this, as opposed to being smooth. And I said, boy, I really like that, you know, that little thing there. And I told him, you know, that my main thing was for it to be light. You know, I was tired of carrying such, you know, heavy piece of wood around my neck. And, you know, the neck had to be to my specs, you know, and then everything else just fell in after that. I mean, the P and J pickups were important, and the reverse is important because I would always hit that pickup. When that pickup is here, it would just mess with me all the time. I just, you know, it was like drove me nuts.
This.
No. It's when I was with Conklin before I was with these guys, Bill told me that He said that was an original design from Fender, from Leo Fender, you know, from the actual guy. And he said that, you know, a lot of people, they don't know that and whatever, but he always kind of latched onto it. And he said, well, I think that's the way we're going to make it for you. And I just held on to it ever since. My influences. I came up with sounds like the Motown sound and Philly and Chicago. And, you know, it seems like back then, you know, parts of the country were associated with the sound. And so I came up like that, you know, James Brown, Sly Stone, and, you know, the players were like James Jamerson, Duck Dunn, Gerald Jamont, Willie Weeks, you know, those kind of cats. So
everybody's asking, what are the EQ settings on your bass?
I play off more of this P pickup. This is just used as a blend, this J pickup. And I, on the bass itself, I got everything pretty much rolled out all the way. And I do whatever has to be adjusted with the amp for the most part. But basically, you know, I just wanted to sound like a bass, you know, and I don't want that twang, and I don't want, you know, any of that clutter that goes with the strings rattling and all that crap. You know, I want it to sound like a bass. It's real important for me. So, you know, you just kind of play with it, and, you know, hopefully you have somebody to help you so they can, like, turn the knobs and you can say, right there, you know. Playing with James Brown was pretty special. The last days at the Fillmore with Aretha live when she recorded, that was real special. Other than that, everything else sucked, man. It's time to bring up another special guest. Sammy, I would like him to introduce himself and tell you who he is.
Hey, how about a round for Rocco? A hand for Rocco first. I got that wrong, didn't I? My name's Sam Aliano. I'm a drummer, originally from Australia. I've been here for about 12 years. I'm working on a record with Slash and Fergie, Steven Tyler, Julian Lennon. Should be coming out in the summer. It's for a good charity. My live work at the moment is with Tony McAlpine, guitar player, and the band Cab. So for any fusion heads, it's with Bunny Brunel and Patrice Russian and Tony. We're about to hit the road again in Japan. For me, I was honored to be asked to come and play, jam a little bit with Rocco. My first NAMM experience was 12 years ago, and I saw Tara Power play for the Sabian night, and it hasn't been the same since, right? So we're just going to jam on some songs.
We're going to do a couple of tunes. Right.
Thanks for having me.
So we're going to attempt to do a couple of things. We're not going to do the whole song, but just kind of the gist of it. We'll be right back. Are we good?
You're good now.
What, are you not smiling? What? Yeah, you. Okay, so we're going to do Soul with a capital S. See if we can get through that.
Thank you.
Don't start just throwing stuff out there. Squib cakes? No. Dead tail. Somebody give them a set list or what? I'm taking orders in the back room. Nah, you can buy them just about anywhere. Oh, you can buy them right here. Yes. Is this him? Is this him? This is one. This is one. This is a five. It comes in a 4-string, 5-string, and a 6-string. Go figure. I don't know. We'll be right back. you to Sammy. Thank you guys for showing up. Thank you.